So just to clarify, if my doctor, who's a very smart guy and a very good guy who only wants to do the right thing, but he is quite busy, so when he does research, he reads medical journals, and if these medical journals are only publishing the articles that are, the studies that are selected, they're not publishing all, just selected ones that are the best studies, and even the best studies, even if they came out good, they might have only been a 6 to 12 week study, we don't know what happens over 5 years, then my doctor's making all these recommendations based on information he's reading in a medical journal that might have the two studies but leaves out the other seven. So how could I feel certain or even confident or comfortable at all that he has accurate information, even though he's got the best of intentions? Why would I think that he has accurate information to recommend any kind of drug to me if his information is so apparently skewed?
It's worse than that. Mm-hmm. It's worse than that because your doctor really doesn't have the time to search through the medical literature. What is your doctor going to do? He or she is going to look at the drug labeling. They still use the PDF, the PDR, the physician drug reference. Physician's drug reference is a compendium of the labels approved by the FDA. Now, what the drug labels will do, in all but one case of antidepressants, there's one exception that I know of, and that's citalopram, Celexa, where they at least mention the existence of failed trials. The drug labeling says the efficacy of for the treatment of major depression has been demonstrated in two clinical trials. No mention is made of the drug trials, and that's what your doctor is going to turn to. There was an official at the FDA, and this is why there's that one exception, Celexa, at the hearing in the process of approving Celexa, citalopram, wrote a memo that is in the FDA files. He wrote a memo saying, actually, I believe that doctors, patients, and third-party funders should be able to know the full data without having to use the Freedom of Information Act and come to us for those data. And I believe further, he said, that labeling, which mentions only the positive trials and neglects to even mention the existence of the negative trials, could be construed as potentially false and misleading. I applaud him, and he had asked to get it done, to get those negative trials mentioned. They were mentioned and dismissed in the labeling for citalopram. As far as I know, they haven't been mentioned since. Seven trials will be done, two will be positive, five will be negative. The label will say it's been demonstrated in two trials, period.
I want to add to that too from my experience, and that is that you can't trust the information that your doctor has unless he is a very diligent researcher and does his own due diligence about everything, and there are very few physicians that have that kind of time or that kind of interest. So what happens is the pharmaceutical reps come in, they take a drug and they go out and they detail the drug, and then they come into the home office or they come into these meetings, these pool meetings, district meetings, and they come back and they tell the company what the physician's concerns are. So then when the company finds out, okay, for example, this drug has an excessive number of CNS side effects, and so the chart that we're using in our detail piece has a graph that shows that, you know, there's 15 or 20% CNS side effects with that. So the next marketing period, when that piece comes out, now they've broken out the CNS side effects into headaches, sleepiness, et cetera, and so forth, so that it minimizes this, and they skew it in a way that statistics become the semantics of research. So it depends on how you present it, on what the interpretation of that data is going to be. And so a lot of doctors depend on those pharmaceutical reps because of their busyness, and they have excellent relationships. don't get me wrong, you'll have doctors tell you almost all the time, oh, well, those pharma reps don't influence what I do. But they don't pay pharma reps the amount of money that they do and give them the benefits and invest all of the time and energy that they do in pharma reps if they don't get a good return on pharma reps. In fact, the statistics show that they get 10 times for every dollar that they invest in a pharma rep, they get 10 times their return. So you have to know these are extremely polished and well-liked people that go in, and they know how to influence doctors because not only are they given the data and the sales training, they're given psychological profiling information on how to best influence a doctor's prescribing habits. So you're literally given all the information that you need to go in and get that doctor to do exactly what you want him to do.